All right, here we go. Okay, friends, here we are. So where were we yesterday? What were we doing?
Something.
Oh, we learned about Mendel, right? And yeah. He looked at his pea plants and what was special about the traits he was looking at. They either had something or didn't, right? It's an either or trait. That was key in what he was being able to look at. It was, there was no blending. There was none of that stuff. It was all about just either you had it or you didn't. Because he was a mathematician, he was able to use probability to be able to help predict what was going on. So that's what exactly probability does. We use probability to predict the mating results of certain offspring. We use probability like on an everyday basis, so to like, what are the chances that someone will say yes to me? Or will, you know, yes. Like if I ask mom and dad to do, you know, to go out to the movies, what are the chances? Oh man, I messed up earlier. You're always constantly thinking about what are the chances that something's going to happen or not going to happen, or winning the lottery or whatever. Anyone going to prom? No.
Possibly.
You're working on it. So there's a low probability. You're not cool enough?
No. I'm a nerd.
What about the what?
The weather.
Oh, yes, probability of the weather. Chance of rain, right? 60% chance of... Does that... When I hear 60% chance of rain, I think that it'll be raining for 60% of the time. Does that make sense?
0% chance.
Out of a 24-hour day, there's going to be like 14 hours at rain. No? That's not what you think?
Like they have like 60% chance at a certain time.
I just think
at all.
Either rain or rain.
Interesting. So, friends... When we talk about the mating results, what is the chance of being a boy? You guys already know this.
50.
It's a 50%. It's a 1/2 probability. What is the chance of being a girl then?
1/2.
1/2 as well. But what is the probability of being of someone having 3 girls in a row?
One.
How'd you get 1/8?
Two times two equals four times two equals eight.
Okay, so. The probability of being a girl each time is 1/2, but the probability of having 3 girls in a row would be 1/8. 1/8 probability. The difference is that just because you have, like if someone has a girl to start with, does that mean they're going to have a boy the second time? Does the probability of having a boy increase because you had a girl to start with?
No.
Each occurrence is independent from one another. Just because you flip a coin, like chances say when you flip a coin 100 times, you're going to get 50 heads and 50 tails. Could you get 100 heads? Could you get 100 tails?
Yeah.
Yes, and you can get any range in between. Probability is not what will happen, it's what's likely to happen. Okay? So, thinking about a dice. You guys know when you play dice, whatever, sevens are winner, right? 7 and 11, really. But let's just do sevens. What's the probability of getting a 7? So what are the different...
I don't know.
Okay, so in order to get a 7, what are the different combinations? 1 and 6. 4 and 3. 5 and 2. And that's it, right?
So it's 3 and 36.
So what's the probability of getting a 1? 1/6. What's the probability of getting a 6?
1/6.
So for a total of?
136.
1 out of 36 chance of getting a 7. Huh?
So giving, that's 3
together. That's, so here we go. It's the probability, it's 1/36th of getting a 1 and a 6. How about a 4 and a 3? 1/6 times 1/6 is 1/36th. That's the key. And that's 1/36 for this one. We add these ones.
Yes.
We multiplied, right? We multiplied these ones because we're asking what's the probability of the two happening together, but then all the separate events added together. So overall, your chances of getting a 7 when you're rolling a pair of dice, is 3 out of 36. That's why they call this gambling. That's why, look, the house, the casino, has a 33 out of 36 chance of you losing.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
If you have a 3 out of 36 chance of winning, you also have a 33 out of 36 chance of losing.
Would it just be 1/12?
Yes. But you had, yeah, you had to go there.
Well, you have to reduce those terms.
Sure. One, yes, 1/12. What was I thinking?
Shame.
If Peter A was here, he would have gotten that sooner, though. That's okay. 1/12 chance. So you have 11 out of 12 chance of losing, which is why the casino's like, yes, come and play. Right? It doesn't seem that bad. Oh, it's just two dice and get, right? But that's the idea. So probability does not mean it will happen. That's what I was trying to say. It doesn't mean it will happen. It just means it's likely to happen. The larger the sample size, yep, we get results closer to what we would predict. If I flip a coin 10 times, yes, I should get 5 and 5, but I might get 7 and 3, which is a huge disparity from the average of what you would expect. But if you flip it 1,000 times, you're likely to be closer to the probability, to the actual prediction. Using probability or seeing ratios in genetics was not really, he wasn't the first person to do that, but he was the first person to go, hey, this actually means something. I can conclude something from it, and that's what this next part is. So this next part, 13.5, is the bulk. It's the meat of this entire, I mean, if you take a look, it goes all the way to the other side down here, okay? So this is the big chunk. All right, let me get a little closer here. That way it won't let me zoom when I'm recording. That's okay. All right, folks, inheritance of alleles. Alleles are what? Different? They're not different genes, they're different?
Traits.
I'm gonna put a word in your mouth. They're different, say it louder. Forms of a gene, good. They're the same gene, means they both code for a color or a specific protein, but that protein is slightly different between the two different alleles. So what Mendel did was something called a monohybrid cross. Mono means one. So we're hybridizing. We're taking two things that are different and combining them, but they're only different in one trait. And they're one trait, crossing two individuals with one trait different. So folks, this down here is our monohybrid cross. Do you guys remember these were true breeding? What does that mean? Green, if I make green with green, I get green. Yellow with yellow makes yellow. Okay. But here, he made the difference. Green with yellow, that's the monohybrid. They only varied in one thing, so that's the monohybrid part of it. And then he looked at the results. So the conclusions he made from his results right here is that each plant, because of this right here, each plant must have two copies of the factor for a trait. But during the process of making the sex cells, only one copy ends up in the gamete. Now we've already learned this, right? Through meiosis, the idea of taking 2N down to 1N. But this was the first time someone thought, no, wait a second, because of the results I'm getting here, that we have green and yellow, make all green, but then we get a 3-to-1 ratio of yellow here. And the F2, right, this is P, this is F1, this is F2. That there must be two copies of each one, and each copy gets passed down. Correct. They could be the same copy or they could be different copies of each other. Now these true breeding ones, they have identical copies. But here, this one must have gotten a copy from that parent and a copy from that parent, so it would have two different copies. And we know that they're called alleles now, but he didn't have the word. He wasn't sure what it was. He just knew that the factor here, there was two factors here, and they combined. This one had to have two factors, but the yellow factor was covered up. And that's what led to the idea of dominance and recessiveness. This is what he called, this idea that the factors can be separated. These genetics can be separated into the gametes. It's called the principle of segregation. What does it mean to segregate?
Separate.
Yep, we want to separate two things apart from each other. And this is how we understand it now. We've seen this. This is meiosis. It's not a big deal. But if you imagine that these are homologous chromosomes, meaning that they have the same genes, but they have different forms of the gene. This one looks like it is a little, that's red. This is blue. So during meiosis, they get split apart. So we have two of them with red and two of them with blue, but red did not stay with blue. They segregated. So the new offspring either gets a red or a blue. That's it. And for those of you listening at home, that's the red, that's the blue. You'll see it on your notes.
So which one is the yellow, like the hidden factor?
In this case, what he said was that the one that was hidden in the F1 generation is recessive. Dominant shows up. Yep, absolutely. Shows up in the F1 generation. So when you start out with true breeding parents, the F1 generation will look like one of the parents because of being dominant. The other ones, that factor is hidden there. It's still there. And how did he know it was still there? Because it reappeared. So it must have still been there somewhere. Go ahead, Kurt.
Is there a way of getting, like for the yellow pad or the recessive one, to increase the odds of getting a recessive?
Is there a way to increase the odds of getting a recessive?
So like the green, is there a way to get more yellows? Like
oh, down here? Yeah. Here's the deal. This is probability. This is probability. This is saying that there is a 75% chance that the offspring will be green and a 25% chance that the offspring will be yellow. Every time this cell fertilizes, and we're going to do that down here in a second, they could have all yellow every time, but the probability is low. So when you have 1,000 different offspring, the likelihood of you getting 1,000 of them that are all yellow is very, very low. It's much more likely you're going to get this ratio. And I think it might help once we do this as well. Yep?
Okay, so if you were to take the yellow one in F2 and made it with the yellow one in the front, the P?
Oh, actually going back and doing that?
Yeah.
That's called a test cross. Well, that kind of is determined by what the genetics are of this thing. And that's what I want to get to next, okay? So dominant traits show up in the F1. Recessive traits are hidden in the F1 when we assume that the parents are true breeding. For a dominant trait, we use capital letters. And this will make sense. And maybe you've done this before, and that's fine. For recessive traits, for the genetics, for the alleles, we use lowercase letters. So let me apply that rule to what I'm about to do here. The genotype for any individual is its genetic makeup. Mendel says you have two factors. You have two copies of the same genes. If they are the same copy, if they're both saying be green, we say you are homozygous, because homo means same. Mono means one. That's what it was. Z-I-G-O-U-S. Homozygous. So in this case, since green is the dominant trait because it shows up in the F1 and the yellow is the recessive, we're going to use the letter G to represent, because we always pick the dominant trait as the letter. So this one right here, we would say, has a genotype, and I'm going to switch colors here just to make it pop out. Its genotype would be Big G, big G. So homozygous can be big G, big G. That's for instance, okay, for as an example. Over here, what is this one's genotype? Well, if it has a big G, it has to be little g, little g, because it shows up as recessive. So big G, or little g. And that's just for this particular trait. That's what it means to be homozygous.
So it's staying the same.
It's, yes, each factor, each allele is the exact same copy. This one says be green, this one says be green. What's the plant? Or what's the pea pod? Green. This one says be yellow, this one says be yellow.
No.
Be yellow. You could also be heterozygous, because hetero means different. So you can be big G, little g. By convention, we always write the capital letter first. If you wrote little g, big G, does it mean the same thing? Yes. We just, by convention, we just write the big G, little g first. So take a look. We're going to do this little Punnett square first and then come back to this one. Look at the parent generation. The parent was big, this is going to be fun.
Yay.
The parent was big G, big G. That's one parent. Remember, these alleles have to separate during meiosis. They have to go to different sex cells. That's a segregation. You do not inherit both G's from one parent. You get one G from one parent, you get another G from another parent. So here's the green one, and here, let's see if this shows up. Does that show up well?
Oh, yeah.
Look at that. That one's yellow, isn't it? So when their genetics recombine, how should we put this together? What is this offspring going to look like? Big G, do you see how we pull the big G's into each one? And I know you guys can already see this, I'm just taking it slow. And then we pull the little G's in. So that means, now does that mean these two parents are gonna have four kids?
No.
What is this? It's a probability. Sahana. Yep. This is a monohybrid cross for two parents that differ in only one trait.
In this case, color?
In this case, the color of the pea pod. Okay, we can do this for anything, but this is where we're starting. So this is a probability. What does this probability mean? Give me a percentage. 100% of the offspring will be what color?
Green.
Green. Because the big G wins over, remember how we talked about, look, take a look. All offspring were green. So what's the genotype of this guy? Big G,
little G.
Little G. That means this is big G, little G. All of them are green. So now we can actually see that little G is still there, isn't it? It was just hidden because it's the recessive trait. If you have a copy that says be green and a copy that says be yellow, the only one that gets turned into a color is the green. And that's just had to do with the DNA sequence in that particular gene. It just wins out. Your body or the plants make that color instead of the yellow. Go ahead, Sarah.
How do you know what trait is dominant?
The dominance and recessive? Her question was, how do you know which one's dominant and which one's recessive? You know the dominance and recessive because of the F1 generation. When you put the green with the yellow, and the green shows up, you know that one's done. If the green and the yellow went together and this one was yellow, it would be the dominant. Yellow would be the dominant. Go ahead, Eric.
Okay, so there's always 100% probability that it'll be green because of that dominant gene?
Because of that in the F1 generation,
right?
That's the key. This is parents going to F1. What did Mendel do next? He took the F1 and went to F2. So take a look. This particular organism, when it makes its gametes, what has to happen to its big G and its little g? They have to separate during meiosis. Take a look. See? The big S, here I have big S, little s, the big S's and the little S's all separated from each other. So this big G has to separate from this little G. So ready? Big G, little G, and we cross it with itself. So another organism just like itself. Big G, little G. Can you guys see it yet?
Yes.
I love this part because this is the simple part. And is this a little bit of a review?
Yes.
For you guys? Okay. Is it okay that I'm taking it this slow?
Yes.
It's okay if you say no too. I can go faster.
Yeah, you should go faster.
Okay. So big G. So what's this one going to be?
Big G.
Big G. Big G. What's this one?
Big G.
Big G. Little G. What's this one down here?
Little G.
Little G. Little G. And this one is?
Big G.
Big G. Little G. Folks, what's the probability of being green?
75%.
75% green and 25% yellow. What is it? What did Mendel observe? That the yellow does reappear approximately 25% of the time. Now, we did this one way. He looked at this and saw this ratio and went, how did that happen? And then he reverse engineered it and said, oh, look, they must have two copies of the same factor. That's the only way I can explain it. That's the only way. He had no idea of really knowing, but mathematically, this is the only way he could show what was happening because he was finding out that he was getting like 250 yellow plants with 750 green ones. And he's like, oh, how does that make such a nice ratio? It's the only way he could explain it, and it is correct. Yep.
Okay, so this is like just a probability. So you could possibly get all yellow?
Sure, yes. Could it be possible that when these mate, the only offspring you get is this one? Sure, there's a 25% chance for each mating occurrence, that each fertilization, that you're going to get yellow.
Okay.
And so it's a low probability, but could it happen? Absolutely. Absolutely. That's why it's a probability. It doesn't mean you have to do it this way. Remember, he found these ratios before he did the Punnett squares. He looked at the results and then reverse engineered and said, well, how do we do this? Okay? Good stuff? All right? All right, so I keep saying genotype. This is its genetic makeup, but then I'm saying green. This guy's green, this guy's green, this guy's green, but are these all the same genetic makeup? No, so they have different genotypes, but the same phenotype. Phenotype means the physical appearance. It's the outward appearance. So if I showed you a green pea pod, would you be able to tell me whether it's homozygous or heterozygous in its genotype? No, you can't always. If I showed you a yellow one, what would you know?
It's
so I say you cannot always tell the genotype. Sometimes, if it's recessive, right? But if it's homozygous or heterozygous dominant, right? You can't. So looking at the outward appearance is not always a good indication. Because if it's dominant, you don't know whether it's homozygous or heterozygous. Okay, good?
Yeah.
Okay, let's bump it up a notch. Have you guys done dihybrid crosses before?
No.
Okay, so this is the new stuff. This is not too bad because it really just builds right on top of stuff you've done before. What does the prefix di mean?
Two.
So we're crossing individuals with
two
different traits. Now let's take a look at something round and wrinkled with yellow or green. So the P can be round or wrinkled, and it can be yellow and green. This is like flipping two coins at the same time. Okay? So what's the probability if I flip one coin of getting heads?
Half.
Just this, you're a little bit ahead. That's okay. What's one half? And if I flip another coin of getting heads is? But the probability of getting heads and heads is?
One
quarter. So my probabilities are going to change here and my Punnett squares get a little bit larger, as you can tell. So in this case, the parental cross, so the P generation, we're going to take these individuals with these genotypes. R, since it's big, is round, which means it's the dominant trait. Little r is
wrinkled.
Big Y is yellow and dominant. Little y is green.
Well,
and not
the green was dominant.
Oh, whoa. Because I'm talking about the peas themselves, not the pea pod.
Oh.
The peas inside have their own color. That's independent
of the pod.
Of the pod. Yeah, that's why he picked them. Is that because he can manipulate each one independently, and it's going to lead to another conclusion. Okay, so here we go. The parental gametes, when this parent, since this is homozygous dominant for both traits, when they go through meiosis, this big R could end up with this big Y in the same sex cell. Or this big R could end up with that big Y. Or this big R could end up with that big Y or that one. So what kind of gametes can the parent make? Big R, Y, or? Well, we're just going to keep the convention here. Nope. R's and Y's have to, the R's have to separate from each other, and the Y's have to separate from each other. So are there any little Y's here? No. So it can make big R, big Y, big R, big Y. It can make big R, big Y, big, can you guys see it? This parent right here, how many different ways can I put an R with a Y?
Four.
Four, but they're all the same. They're all the same. I can tell I'm getting you guys now, right? This is the new stuff. So this parent can make big R, big Y. If you guys forget about the Y's for a second, look at just RR. If these R's have to separate, right, during meiosis? So the R has to separate. So does the Y. But the R's and the Y's will end up in the same sex cell. So you get an R and a Y in a sex cell. Because if the sex cell has an R and a Y, and the other sex cell has an R and a Y, when they recombine, the new organism has two R's and two Y's, which is what they want.
Can you explain that using the diagram on the other page?
Over here?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Imagine we had a whole nother set of chromosomes in here that was a big R and a big R, right? I'm trying to squeeze it in there, okay? And then that big R would be down here copied for each one. That means each one of these is going to get a big R.
And then the S would be a Y?
Yep, and the S would be a Y. It would have to be that way.
Okay.
I understand, it's a little tougher to see, but we'll keep practicing. So that means this parent can make big R, big Y, big R, big Y, big R, big Y, or big R, big Y. What can this parent make?
Little R
with a little Y, or little R with that little Y, or little R with that little Y, or really all this parent can make is little R, little Y. So we go little R, little Y, little R, little Y, little R, little Y, little R, little Y. Fantastic. Now all we have to do is fill in the Punnett square. So what's this person's genotype?
RYR.
Let's big R, little R, big Y, little Y. What's this one? Oh, you mean they're all going to be the same?
Yeah.
So you mean when I have two true breeding parents, all of the offspring will have
the same
genotype. What's their phenotype?
Round and yellow.
So I'm going to write this out. 100% big R, little R, big Y, little Y. And 100%, what's their phenotype again?
Round and yellow.
Round, yellow. What happened to the wrinkled and green trait? It's recessive. It got hidden, right? Is it still in there?
Yes.
We know it's still in there with the genetics. Now, so do you see how I didn't have to actually do the rest of this Punnett square? You don't have to fill it all in, dude.
I already started this. So
because you can't start. No, you don't have to do it all the way. It's all this is moot.
I already started.
It's not necessary because it's, anyway.
So why is it just part of like R, little R, Y, little Y? Like, is that just a pattern?
Yeah, because they're homologous chromosomes. They're the same size and structure.
Yeah.
All right, so folks, now we're going to do the F1 self-cross, which means I'm going to take these bad boys. Ready? Here's the parent. Big R, little R, big Y, little Y is going to cross with big R, little Y. Does that make sense? Now, yes. Now, here's where we get the variety. Here's where we get... I mean, if you think about it, when we did the monohybrid cross, look, we had almost no variety here, right? It was all the same. Here, we got variety, didn't we? But now, since we're doing double the traits, it's two instead of one, it's a squared function, so now it's four times the amount of work. You want to do a trihybrid cross next?
Yes.
No.
How many squares would a trihybrid be?
32. No, 64.
64, good, good. Channeling Peter. Channeling Peter.
He's in the Peter spot also.
He's in the Peter spot?
Yeah.
Is that just Peter's seat? Okay, so when these genetics recombine, big R can be with?
Big Y.
So an R has to go with a Y, right? So big R with?
Big Y.
Big Y, or big R with? Or little r with,
big y.
Or little r with.
Little y.
So let's write these gametes. Big R, big Y. Big R, little y. Little r, big Y. Little r, little y.
Shouldn't you write y first?
Nope.
No.
I understand what you're saying because that's the capital.
It's the second trait.
It's the second trait, so we're going to keep it there. We're always going to put the R's first and the Y second just to keep track. So what is this parent over here going to make?
Same.
The same. So big R, big Y. Big R, little y. Little r, big Y. Little r, little y.
Yay, fun. Woo-hoo.